last night.
Didn't mean that.
Oh, well. What's the purpose of having a non-traditional career if you can't have non-traditional hair color, right? No? All right. Never say that again. Okay, I'm going to get started. First, I'd like you to think of something that you did today that was difficult. I know it's early, so maybe that was an alarm clock, or maybe it was a conversation or a test. I want you to imagine something that you've been through this week or this month that was difficult, that you struggled through, that you might still carry with you. And maybe this year, recognize what you've been through and remember it. And I invite you in this moment to recognize wherever you are in the process of that thing, that you made it here today to this very moment, to this auditorium, and that fact is worth celebrating. So with that in mind, I'd like to dedicate this first poem to you. Dear you, whoever you are, however you got here, this moment has waited its whole life for you. This moment is your lover and you are a soldier. Come home, baby, it's over. You don't need to suffer anymore. Dear you, this moment is your surprise party. You are both hiding in the dark and walking to the door. This moment is a hallelujah. This moment is your permission slip to finally open that love letter you've been hiding from yourself. The one you wrote when you were little, when you still danced like a sparkler at dusk. Do you remember the moment you realized they were watching? When you became ashamed of how much light you were holding? When you first learned how to unlove yourself? Dear you, the word today means amen in every language. Today, we made it. Today, I'm gonna love you. Today, I'm gonna love myself. Today, the box cutter will rust in the garbage. The noose will forget how to hold you. Today, dear you, and I have always meant you. Nothing would be the same if you did not exist. You, who were once as small as a bouquet, who slept in the laps of strangers, nothing would be the same if you did not exist. You, whose voice is someone's favorite voice, someone's favorite face to wake up to, nothing would be the same if you did not exist. You, the teacher, the starter's gun, the lantern in the night who offers not a way home but the courage to travel farther into the dark. You, the lover, who worships the taste of her body, who is the largest tree ring in his heart, who does not let fear ration your love. You, the friend, the sacred chorus of how can I help you, who have felt more numb than holy, more cracked than mosaic, who have known the tiles of a bathroom by heart, who have forgotten what makes you worth it. You, the forgiven, the forgiver, who belongs right here in this moment. You, this clump of cells, this happy explosion that happened to start breathing by the grace of whatever is up there. You got here, you made it this whole way, through the nights that swallowed you whole, the mornings that arrived in pieces, the scabs, the gravel, the doubt, the hurt. The hurt is over today. You made it. You made it. You made it here. Thank you.
Thank you.
What are the over-under odds that I dumped this on myself by accident? All right, I'm fighting a cold, so if I cough in the middle of the piece, just pretend that it's like dramatic interpretation. How many people here are in love? Literally like two people. I see you, man. All right, how many people here have a crush on someone? Volunteer for tribute. Cool. How many people here have a crush on someone in the room? Hey. There's an odd number, that's not good. How many people here, important question, how many people here have ever felt any emotion ever? Awesome, cool, great. For the people with your hands down, there's help for that. It's called sugar, actually. All right, how many people here have ever had a crush on or been in love with someone who was in love with someone else? Yeah. You know what's funny is, like, normally when I ask these questions, the dudes in the back are like this, and then I ask this question, and at least one in the audience is like, I know that, girlfriend. All right. So, I was in love with one of my best friends for over 3 years,
And I like to say all I got was this stupid poem. Not even a t-shirt. I shouldn't say that joke again either. I have a list of invisible things that I should never say. This poem, this is called "On Watching Someone You Love Love Somebody Else." It sucks. No, that's not the poem. That's like the Spark Notes version of it. TLDR. But I'll make up for being so sad and petty by telling a funny story about this poem afterwards. But first, the pettiness. You will be out with friends when the news of her existence is accidentally spilled all over your bar stool. Respond calmly, as if it was only a change in weather, a punchline you saw coming. After your fourth shot of cheap liquor, leave the image of him kissing another woman in the toilet. In the morning, her name will be in every headline. Car crash, robbery, flood. When he calls you, ignore the hundreds of ropes untangling themselves in your stomach. You are the best friend again. When he invites you over for dinner, say yes too easily. Remind yourself, this isn't special. It's only dinner. Everyone has to eat. When he greets you at the door, do not think for one second you are the reason he wore cologne tonight. Someone told you once that a soulmate is not the person who makes you the happiest, but the one who makes you feel the most, who can conduct your heart to bang the loudest, who can drag you giggling with forgiveness from the cellar they locked you in. It has always been him. In his kitchen, he will hand feed you a piece of red pepper. His laugh will be low and warm, and it will make you feel like candlelight. Do not think this is special. Do not count on your fingers the number of freckles you could kiss too easily. Try to think of pilot lights or olive oil, not everything you have ever loved about him, or it will suddenly feel boiling and possible and so close. You will find her bobby pins lying innocently on his bathroom sink. Her bobby pins. They look like the wiry legs of spiders. Splinters of her undressing in his bed. Do not say anything. Think of stealing them, wearing them home in your hair. When he hugs you goodbye, let him kiss you on the forehead. Settle for target practice. At home, you will picture her across town, pressing her fingers into his back like wet cement. You will wonder if she looks like you, if you are the same, if you have the same features, if you fell for you like rearranging furniture. When he kisses her, does she taste like new paint? You will want to call him. You will go as far as holding the phone in your hand. Imagine telling him unimaginable things like, you are always ticking inside of me, and I dream of you more often than I don't. My body is a dead language, and you pronounce each word perfectly. Do not call him. Fall asleep to the hum of the VCR. She must make him happy. She must be his favorite place in Minneapolis. You are a souvenir shop where he goes to remember how much people miss him when he's gone. Thank you. So the funny story about that poem is nothing. No, just kidding. The funny story is that, so we're still friends. He's seen the poem. Because we're artists and we're weird like that. And he lives in Los Angeles now with the same woman, so that's great, I'm fine. but that poem is on YouTube, which is just like the proverbial, like, screw you, look at all the views your pain caused me, you jerk. But my favorite thing on the internet, the entire internet, is a response comment to this poem that just says, "But really, who owns a VCR anymore?" And then my second favorite thing on the internet is a response comment to that comment that says, "I think it's just a metaphor for living in the past." I've never been dragged more by a stranger in my life. Back off, internet. It's just the only way I can watch Jurassic Park. This next poem is for my grandfather. My grandfather was a fantastic man. He was a college professor. He was actually like a professional storyteller, incredibly long-winded. It's probably where I get it from. So much so that he once wrote and self-published an autobiography that he then wrapped up and gave to all of his grandchildren for Christmas. And yeah, I was like, oh, thanks, a book you wrote at 14. I was a jerk. But even then, I thought that that book was for us, his grandchildren, his family, to know his life. But a couple years after he wrote it, he was diagnosed with dementia. And there was a point at which, before he passed away, when he could no longer remember the names of his children or recognize his wife's face, his wife of 50 years, and my family and I would read to my grandfather out of his own autobiography. And if that isn't poetry, I don't know what is. So this is for my grandfather. This is your wife, Barbara. That's your son, Scott. That's you in your Navy uniform waiting for that train to come. You always told me that you only chose the Navy because the uniform matched the color of your eyes. Remember? My grandfather coughs. I hand him a water bottle. Over the past hour, we've been alternating between a photo album and me reading aloud to him from his 400-page self-published autobiography. When he fumbles, I open the water bottle for him. Our hands touch, and his doughy eyes look up at me, wet with recognition. On the front page of the photo album is a note from the nursing home staff. In big kindergarten-style letters, it reads, "You have a disease that affects your memory. We are here to help." Look, Grandpa, it's the house you grew up in, the farm. That's your sister's. You always told me that your sisters used to put on extra layers of clothing in the morning before milking the cows so the smell of manure wouldn't follow them to school. Do you remember your sisters? His words come out like shy children, slow and hesitant. He tells me he remembers but does not say more. I read somewhere that people with dementia might lie or pretend to understand to avoid embarrassment. I try not to think about this and turn the page. That's you and Grandma playing guitar. You always said that she played bad and you played worse. I remember when you taught me my first chord. It was a G chord. Remember? The bathtub is slowly draining, the photograph developing in reverse, all those words just floating about, his mouth an empty mason jar, the fireflies just out of reach. My grandfather picks up his autobiography, holds it up in the air as if handing it to God, and says the most words he has said to me all day. Did I actually write this? I don't remember. If dementia is the body's longest goodbye, then let these be the last memories it pries from your fingers. This is your wife, Barbara. You told me the summer you eloped, her skin was sunburned the color of a cherry. This is your son, Scott. He has your eyes, navy blue. This is the house you grew up in. This is you teaching. This is you playing guitar. This is your granddaughter. She wants to be a teacher like you. This is you. This is it. In the end, this is all that is left. The memories, the moments, the people who will love you to the body's unflattering end. How quickly time passes us by. Just yesterday, it seems, you were waiting for that train. It's here, Grandpa. It finally came. Thank you. All right, I'm gonna do a ridiculous poem that I don't perform that often because it's actually getting outdated. How many people here listen to Katy Perry? Good. Cool. Great. How many people here have ever heard her song, "You're So Gay"? Cool. History lesson. She once made a song called "You're So Gay," like demasculating her significant other and like insulting him as if like gay could ever be an insult. And I feel like there are literally a billion things you could do with your time, money, talent, than like insult someone's sexuality. So this is for Katy Perry, and it starts with a quote from her song. Really, really expert writing. can't believe I fell in love with someone who wears more makeup than I do. I hope you hang yourself with your H&M scarf while whacking off listening to Mozart. Katy Perry. Don't confuse it with me. Katie, when you have a child, I hope the ultrasound technician makes a mistake. I hope you buy everything in pink. I hope you purchase Barbies and nail polish in bulk. I hope you pick the most delicate name like Petunia or Lavender. I hope you get everything personalized, and I hope you lose all your receipts. On that fateful day, when your body opens itself like a gift, Katie, I hope you have a boy. I hope your son comes out of your womb so flaming your vagina is permanently bedazzled. I hope his first words are the lyrics to Rent. I hope his first steps are shuffle, shuffle, ball, change, jazz hands. On Halloween, I hope he dresses up as a Powerpuff Girl or Barbara Streisand. Katie, when your son Lavender goes to prom, I hope he wears a velvet gown. I hope that boy feels beautiful. I hope he loves to dance. The DJ will have a thing for oldies that night, a craving for the good old days of auto-tune. He will play your song, the one that bullies masculinity, that uses your son's identity as a checklist for what real men don't do, don't care about your body, don't care about your clothing, don't cry, don't glitter, don't dance, don't love his body like Broadway lights, don't love like proud saxophone. Katie, it's official. You've made making fun of gay people cool again. Why don't you just release a line of designer no homo handbags or a fragrance called Ignorance by Katy Perry? Why don't you just write a song called I Like to Pin and Hold My Lovers in the Caveman Archetype so I can be content being a submissive woman, but I'm secretly afraid of gay people because I want to be the only princess at the party. Katie, if someone wrote a song called You're So Jewish or I Kiss a Black Man, no red carpet would bloom before them. No one would celebrate lyrics listing all the ways you think Koreans or people with disabilities are less worthy of your love. Now, Katie, I like my lovers with a little glitter. I like men who can talk about poetry and who aren't afraid of the tampon monster. I like men who admit they cry during Shrek Ever After and Where the Wild Things Are like I did. So, Katie, when your son Lavender comes home from prom, his makeup smeared, his tiara still shining, I hope you have answers, Katie. I hope you tell that boy you are proud. Thank you. All right. You say the word vagina in a high school auditorium, and it's like... little whisper cockroaches or something. All right. How am I doing? So this next piece... Vagina, vagina, vagina. Done. Okay. Palate cleanser. Mayonnaise. I don't know. Okay, so... this next poem is for my sister, and a little backstory, a couple things. One, I write a lot to understand myself, and I write a lot to understand the world around me, and writing has been a tool so that I can better know myself. But that being said, I never knew that I would learn the most about myself by helping someone else through something. I think the person that we are when our friends are going through a hard time, where our family's going through a hard time, and their relationships are no longer comfortable, right? When it's no longer convenient or helpful to your life, and how you show up to that is something really indicative of who you are or can teach you a lot. So I learned a lot about myself through my relationship with my sister, helping her through something. And we grew up in upstate New York in a tiny rural farming town. I was raised by hippies. My middle name is Fawn, if that gives you an essence of my childhood. And I tried to include a lot of imagery from upstate New York in this poem. And it's also prefaced by a Richard Sykin line. Richard Sykin is a modern poet right now. And the line is, "The landscape after cruelty, which is, of course, a garden." So this is for my sister. Blackberry briar, hunter's daughter, ocean-eyed mermaid. When my sister needs to talk, I extend my arms towards her like a child asking to be held. I turn my palms upward as if donating blood and let her empty the contents of her day on me. Her words file out, orderly at first, and then a swarm, spilling over me like the soft swell of a mushroom cloud until I do not remember where I begin and her need ends. Once I held a newborn baby in my arms, 3 weeks old, naked as truth comes, she felt so small. Her heartbeat a moth I trapped between my palms. This is what it's like to love the healing. If my sister's eating disorder were a person, it would be a teenager by now. I imagine it, doorknobs for knees, long, graceful fingers like the legs of ballerinas, the beaks of cranes. It would have a favorite book, a locker combination, a best friend, her. I tell her I won't let her live in my house if she lets it sleep over. I tell her I can't see it, but I know it's there. I tell her nothing, and just let the cloud of her day rise like dough. Milkweed woman, catacomb breast, this is how to love the healing. To be not the sound, but the receptacle. To be not the paint, not the blank canvas, not even the sweat of creativity, but to be the bed the artist crawls back to. Tonight, I rub my sister's shoulders. My thumbs mistake her back for the staircase in my childhood home. She tells me that she is scared, that the waves are rising and the ship is begging to become driftwood. The hounds are howling tonight and the moon is so full it could burst. She tells me that she has been symptom-free for 3 weeks. 3 weeks, it feels so small. A newborn, a heartbeat, a fluttering of smothered wings, but sister, this is what it's like to heal, to get up again and again when the waves come, to retrain the hounds of your body, dragonfly, child of stone and moss, you are dancing this dance you know by heart, you are crawling out from under yourself, spring drinker, sap collector, you are drawing a map to forgiveness, where you live, where you already are, you just don't know it yet, perfect isn't where we're from and we wouldn't like it there anyway, big sister, little dipper, who taught me how to sing the way light streams through a window, how to live boldly and without shame, sister. When we were little, I didn't know what it was like to face the dark, twisting woods behind our house alone. When I think of what courage is, sweet sapling, falcon of a woman, I see your hand reaching back for me, leading me into the forest, into the unknown, the seam of your shoulder, the horizon of your voice, saying, look, I've got you, I'm here. Blackberry briar, gardener's daughter, you were born to walk through this. You were made to travel that long journey into yourself. Now look into the distance. I'm there if you need me, arms out, ready to listen, ready to sing, sweet sister, I've got you, I'm here. Thank you. All right, I'm gonna do three more. Then we'll do a little Q&A. Haven't spilled this on myself yet. It's a long day. Okay, so I'm gonna do another poem. I'm like doing a family themed set, apparently. This poem is for my niece. My niece is a badass. She's 10 now. She was 8 when I wrote this poem. She once asked my sister, her mother, what a penis flytrap was. Good one. She also, my sister was like, her name is Livia, like Olivia without the O, and she was like, Livy, if you could tell the whole world, if you could have the whole world know one thing about you, what would it be? And Livia is like very studious and she has like a really big vocabulary, and she was like, I would want them to know that I want to live in the wild and run with the panthers. I'm 30 and I would be like, I like cookies. A quick thing to know about this poem, I wrote it when I was living in Los Angeles. Every year in Los Angeles, I do a 6-week residency out there at a nonprofit that works with literacy and teenagers in the high school system. And Los Angeles has some of the lowest, it's like in the bottom 4 of literacy in the public school districts in the country, and also some of the highest rates for gang recruitment and sex trafficking recruitment. So if you could think about those elements like in your education system, where you go to school, it's really challenging. So that's kind of where my mind was at when I was writing this poem. This is for my niece, Livia, age 8. It is 90 degrees in Los Angeles this morning, and I'm drinking hot mint tea. So much, in fact, I've probably peed at least 6 times in the last 2 hours. My voice is sore and not ready to face the day. My throat is a field, a cavern, a hill up which 100 words crawl. Sometimes it acts more like a water slide, thoughts running to the top only to slip back down on their bellies. Livia, I realized this morning that one day soon you will be old enough to read my poetry. A scary thought for your parents, no doubt, but no more alarming than the fact that soon your child body will swell and stretch like an unfamiliar dress. Soon, you will realize that everyone in the world is afraid of looking stupid, and therefore you too will become afraid of looking stupid. I want you to know it wasn't always like this. Once, you entered the bathroom while I was brushing my teeth. Mid-conversation, you pulled down your pants and proceeded to sit on the toilet, your tiny feet barely brushing the tile floor. No pause, no embarrassment, quite literally business as usual. You made soft grunting noises, as your body did what every body does. I know that when you're old enough to read my poetry and you find this poem, the one about the sounds you made while shitting, you will probably be embarrassed, maybe even hate me a little, I'm sorry. Maybe it's the quirky aunt in me. Perhaps it's the poet who finds something thrilling about unapologetic sounds, the dashing glory of childhood that curdles at the arrival of shame, how in that moment you reminded me of my own animal, my heirloom fear of being wild, how you, plank-legged fairy, princess of the wolves, have taught me how to screech like an owl or its witch. Livia, I'm warming my voice today and I feel like I'm lacing up my armor. I feel as though I'm off to fight the dragons, or better yet, to befriend them. I'm trying to teach poetry in school districts that only know how to starve. I'm trying to show my students who don't know how to spell, how to write their lives in anything but blood. I'm trying to learn how to give and foster forgiveness in a body that wants none of it. When you are finally old enough to read my poetry, I think we will have a lot of catching up to do. Each poem is a different thread of me. Soon you can read each crude, screeching, slimy, heart-wrecked line, my sweet firecracker, my toothy walnut. Your mother has already given you your bookish vocabulary, which includes words like feeble, specific, and galactic, abnormally large for the average 8-year-old Livia. Your words are weapons. Your voice is the strength it takes to wield them. Better yet, let's free ourselves of violence, as you have only ever been a valiant champion of tenderness. Livia, your words are lightning bugs. Your voice is the darkness that allows them to glow. Please know every sound you have ever made or will ever make will only lead to grace. So until then, until we can swap poems and cartons of ice cream, I leave you this note. I'm thinking of you on this scalding day as I drink my tea. I'm imagining your skinny legs and your simmering laugh and your bursting eyes and the way you climb so confidently into my lap to snuggle with your aunt, even though you are getting so big and so wise, and so soon you will be old enough to read all of this. Thank you. Done at 10:15? All right, I'm gonna do two more poems. This next poem, this is one of the oldest poems that I still perform, and I stopped performing it for a while. I just got sick of it on my set list. I've been doing this full time for 7 years. I performed in 40 of the 50 states and 6 international shows, and I stopped performing it for a while and then brought this poem back because of things that were going on in my friends' lives, in my students' lives, on the news. I think that the topic of this next poem is one of the oldest wars we have ever fought. And I invite you, if you don't relate to this poem, to its topic, or you don't have a reason to relate to it in your life, then I invite you to recognize what a privilege it is to not relate to this topic, and to maybe examine how you can be a better ally or advocate for the people in your lives that do. We are taught from the moment we leave our pink nurseries that we are collapsible paper dolls, light to hold, easier to crumple, that as women, our worth lives secretly wrapped in lace and cotton panties, our fragility armored with pepper spray and mace. They say 1 in 10, 1 in 6, 1 in 3 women will be raped or sexually abused in their lifetime, and I am 1 of 3 daughters. Now imagine, each victim is an acrobat. Her sanity, a balancing act. Our response is the unfailing safety net. We never expect to see her across the wire. You weren't just violated, we tell her. You are an empty museum, a gutted monument to what used to hold so much worth. And with the best intentions, we tell her to reclaim it. Put a price tag on your rape and own it, but don't stand too tall, don't act too strong. We will name you denial. Come back when you're ready to crumble, like your bones are made of chalk. You may only laugh cutely or cry beautifully, so cry beautifully. We will catch you. We are calling it theft. As if he could pluck open your ribs like cello strings, pocket your breast, steal what makes your heart flutter and tack its wings to his wall. Some days you will feel dirty. Some weeks you remember just how hard it is to breathe in public, like your heartbeat is climbing to the attic of your throat only to suicide itself on the pavement. But know this, the person who did this to you is broken, not you. The person who did this to you is out there somewhere choking on the glass of their chest. It is a windshield and his heartbeat is a baseball bat. Regret this, nothing was stolen from you. Your body is not a hand-me-down, and there is nothing that sits inside you holding your worth. No locket that could be seen or touched, ripped from your stomach to be left on the concrete. And I know it's hard to feel perfect when you can't tell an Adam's apple from a fist, because some ashtray of a man picked you to play his Eden, but I will not watch you collapse. Thank you. All right, one more poem. So I have two of my most recent books for sale, if you're interested in them. I take credit cards because it's the future, and I'm also available on all social medias. I literally just got Snapchat. I don't even know what it is. And there's also I don't have a ton left, but I have some flyers with my face on it, which is weird, but it has my information and my name on it. So come say hi afterwards if you're interested. I'd love to take some questions in a little bit. Thank you. There are my books. So this will be my last poem. So my friend Ariel and I worked together in a restaurant. The first 3 weeks of our friendship, the only things I said to her were, "Where the heck is the ketchup?" And, "Oh my God, this mop smells like oranges and ass." At the same time. Ariel walks into every room like she's late for something, but she left her give a heck at home. Between shifts, we bond over awesome things like knitting and Ani DeFranco, and I've slowly acquired the following fascinating facts about her life. She rides a motorcycle. She can make herself burp on command, which she does musically. And she once owned a pet bunny named Nell, spelled with a silent G, that she used to carry around in her sweater when she went out to the bar every night. Live animal. You guys, is that a new thing that happens all the time? This, I learned, was before the rehab. Ariel tells me she's not the type of person who needed rehab, but says she knows herself more because of it. I believe her. There is something about people who have seen their own wild darkness, who've had sadness cast itself like iron before them, the ones who mistook that empty hallway of depression for a mirror. Ariel has 6 fat scars like the rungs of a ladder down her forearm. I have never asked her about them, and I don't want to. I already know everything she has to say. I, too, have seen what spills from this body. I, too, have listened to the dull lullaby of the bathtub drain, fantasized about how many refrains it would take to end it. I have thought about ending it, getting off this carousel. Depression is a black sheep. We all have one, but some of us still talk to it. Some of us haven't disowned it yet. Looking back, I am thankful this body is an obedient machine. It will keep doing what it's doing until it is told not to. Looking back, I am surprised at how few scars I have, how I actually survive myself. My favorite thing about Ariel is her tattoos. They're awful. Ariel has a tattoo of a mermaid above each of her breasts. They look like they were drawn by my 5-year-old niece while she's on a sleeping pill. Depending on what day it is or what shirt she wears, they look more like pickles than sea creatures. And I tell her I love her tattoos. And I do. I love that they're messed up. I love that she's messed up. I love that she was messed up and got her life together. These days, I don't own a box cutter. These days, I don't grind my teeth while I'm sleeping, and this was never meant to be a poem. This is only meant to be a reminder that you and I are never truly alone in all this. Whatever you felt last night, whatever needle was stitching its initials into your heart was felt by 100 other hearts. Whatever growls in the darkest corner of your memory is a beast that others have fed. You are not the only person who feels ugly today. You are not the only person who can't seem to find the right words until the conversation is over, who doesn't know what they're doing on this carousel, who cries for no reason or never cries or only cries when you feel like your life is finally standing still and you don't know what to do when nothing is going wrong. When I told Ariel I wrote a poem about her, she called me an asshole and asked if I would read it to her while wearing a beret. I accidentally mopped her coat, which now smells like oranges and ass. It's not about always being happy. That's unhealthy. But you are only truly alone if you ignore all the other people who are exactly like you. Thank you. Thank you. Anybody have any questions? In the bike. Yep. I think Katy Perry is really beautiful and really talented. I'll leave it at that. I'm sure she's a wonderful person. But sometimes you need a call out. She needed to do better in that moment. Anybody else?
Sierra, when you write a poem, do you usually write it all at once, or do you like find fragments of words that you like and try to put them together? What's that process?
It's a little bit, sometimes it's one way and sometimes the other. I'll write a full draft generally or work on it a lot. I don't know, it's kind of a collection, right? Sometimes if I have an idea, it just like comes out, and other times I gotta wrestle with it more. I am a huge proponent of like the workshopping process. I don't ever just write, actually a couple times, I heard Mike answer this earlier, like a couple times I've written a poem and it's just been that, but like the Paper Dolls poem about sequential assault and my unrequited love poem, those really took months of rounds of edits because I just wanted them to be right, you know? Katy Perry poem I wrote in like 5 seconds because I was angry. Yeah. Yes, actually, wait, you were talking the whole set, so I'm gonna ask other people first. Doesn't hurt my feelings, really, because I'm an adult and I'm paid to be here. Yes, sir. I can't hear my friend. Some of my favorite poets are a poet named Dinez Smith, who lives in the Twin Cities, Guante, who's a rapper, and also a spoken word artist. I really love Sharon Olds, Jason Schinder, who are both page poets, Richard Sykin, who I referenced earlier. But if you're interested at all in spoken word, I would really, or poetry at all, just check out like buttonpoetry.com or Button Poetry's YouTube. There we have like hundreds and hundreds of videos of spoken word from poets from across the country. I could list 100 right now just because I think it's really important to consume your craft, right? Like, if I'd be like, oh, it's me, I'm my favorite poet, I'd be a terrible person and probably a terrible poet too. But those are my favorites right now. Anybody else? Yes, sir.
I love that question.
So you're essentially asking about like writer's block, right? So I used to say, and I still believe, this is like phase one of my answer. Phase one of my answer is go find, like I was saying, go listen to poems that you like. Go find inspiration. Go study your craft, like consume your craft, because if you can find out what you like and what you don't like, you can emulate that or not emulate that. You know, it's like when I get stuck, I often write poems after someone, like, oh, I'll write a poem after Mike McGee and I'll like steal a line and be inspired by him or something. But phase two, something that I just realized that I wanted to start saying in Q&As is that we really have to break down what writer's block is. It's totally real and it's real not to be inspired, but what it is your subconscious saying that you have nothing good or important to write about. It's your subconscious saying, like, you don't have a story, your opinion doesn't matter, you're talentless, and you have nothing to write about, right? And so my number one thing is, like, go write a bad poem. Like, if you're not inspired, write a poem about, like, a chair, right? And then suddenly that poem turns into the chair. It's a persona poem from the perspective of the chair that, I don't know, the president sits in. Or all of a sudden, you know, that bad poem that you allowed yourself to write turns into something that you wanted. Does that make sense? I write 10 bad lines to get to my 11th one, and I cut the first 10. I'm all about the process of getting there, like thinking of it as stepping stones. You don't turn back and like carry your stepping stones with you once you get to where you want to go. So my number one thing would be like, if you're uninspired, write a crappy poem. Like write a poem about something that doesn't like invoke that passion in you. Just show up for the work. Yes?
Has your niece, Livia, read your poems yet?
That's a great question. I performed in Hawaii this summer, and I brought my niece and my sister along like as like a family vacation, and she came to my set, and so she's heard the poem about her, and she's heard a chunk of the poems that you saw today. She left the room for a couple that were, you know, a little bit more mature for her. I was like, go away. But yes, she's heard it. She's heard it.
She likes it?
She does. She loves it. I mean, she's a kid, so anything about her, she's like, ah, you know. she likes it. She writes her own poetry. It's pretty cute. Yeah. One day I'll, like, give her my book. Yes? At this point, it's not an everyday thing, but like I said earlier, I've been touring full-time, essentially, for 6 or 7 years. So a lot of my job is administrative. Like, a lot of my job is being a professional artist and what comes with that, which is, like, booking and marketing and promotion and whatever, and ruining your hair in a hotel room in the middle of Illinois. That's where I am right now, right? But I was in Los Angeles like 26 hours ago, and today I will fly to New York. No, it's not. But when I have a deadline, when both of those books over there, I had a pretty vicious deadline, and at that point I clocked in 9 to 5 if I could. Right now, when I don't have a deadline, when I don't have a process, and I'm not extremely passionate about something, I try to show up at least once a week. To write for a couple hours, but at this point it's not an everyday thing, but it was at one point, or it becomes that when I need it to, if that makes sense. It's National Poetry Month right now, and a lot of poets across the country are doing like what's called a 30-30, where they write one poem a day for 30 days, and I do that a lot in any month. I just try to write one poem a day, because that at least gets a lot of content out of me. Yeah, and yes? Write a poem, you said? I think I struggled with the unrequited love poem for probably 3 to 4 months. And editing, like I'd write something and then I'd leave it or cut it. And then it would just went through lots of different variations. And that might have just been like denial, like emotional like baggage. But yeah, a couple months probably.
There's a question over on the left side.
Yes.
I
don't know. It was I've been on the gray phase for the past year, so I've been, and it's too hard. If anybody wants to dye their hair gray, it's just not worth it. It doesn't stay. It goes away in like one wash. So I've been trying to maintain it, and I got dye last night, and I wanted to put a tint of teal in it, and my hair was like, uh-uh, girlfriend, sucked it all up and made it this color. I'm fine with it. I mean, thank you. Over there, yes.
Do you create other
forms of media? I sort of do. I'm writing my very first YA novel for like young readers. Think like James and the Giant Peach. And I have a novel storyboarded right now, but it's really hard for me. It feels like writing with my left hand. I am a painter, and I was like a visual artist until I discovered poetry. Any other questions? Yes?
Do you have like a special place that you like to write?
That's a great question. I have an office and a desk that I try to like do my work at and show up for, but I find myself like writing in my bed. Like I like to sit and kill my back and type. I write on the computer. I write out loud a lot. I can't write in coffee shops or else I'd seem like a little mentally unwell. So I find myself writing at home in my bed. Yes. How did I get my, that's a great question. It was very serendipitous and it was a lot of luck, timing, hard work, and like stupidity maybe. I discovered spoken word when I was 19 in college, and all of my creative energy, I used to be an art major, like shifted, and I started performing, and then I started performing at these national tournaments, and I got a certain amount of visibility, and I just sort of followed it with a lot of passion, without looking back. And I probably got my biggest break in 2009. I got my first book published, I won the National Poetry Slam, and I placed at these big tournaments, which just basically gave me visibility. And ever since then, it's just been tiny steps, you know? A poem that I wrote and published 7 years ago is the reason why I got my first national book published, meaning like I put it out and somebody at this national publishing company saw it 5 years later and gave me this great book deal. Or Paper Dolls just went super viral, whatever, that doesn't even matter, but because it was seen, a poem that I wrote probably 6 years ago, because it was seen, I just, you guys are the first people that I'm telling, I just wrote a poem for a Nike ad because of Paper Dolls that I wrote 5 years ago. So it's just like tiny little steps that are building up, you know. I've also been, yeah, does that make sense? That was a really long-winded answer. Yes? Inspiration to write? Really from like the experience of being human, right? Like the good things and all the bad things. That'll be my thing.